evening and welcome to the Longmont Public Library. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay. And this wonderful program that we have for you this evening, this humanities program that we have planned, a commemoration of the 100th anniversary of the signing of the armistice which ended the Great World War. My name is Betty Jo Brenner, and I coordinate programs for Colorado Humanities. The events of this weekend of our commemoration are the culmination of over 2 years of planning and programming developed by your Colorado World War I Centennial Commemoration Committee. This has been a comprehensive project involving multiple partners from a variety of disciplines, from film to book discussions, to art and historical exhibits, to lectures and panel discussions. We hope that our efforts have helped you all to remember America's participation in World War I. 4.7 million American men and women stepped forward to serve in uniform during World War I. 2 million of those men and women deployed overseas to the fight. 116,000 of those American men and women never made it home. The new National World War I Memorial in Washington, D.C. is a gift to America's future generations so that they can learn from the legacy and lessons from the men and women who served 100 years ago. Our program this evening is a Chautauqua presentation, which means it's a first-person dramatization of a historic figure. It's a monologue in character by our speaker as W.E.B. DuBois, followed by a Q&A period in character first for a period of 10 or 15 minutes, and then out of character as the scholar. You can ask questions. Scholar and activist W.E.B. DuBois was born on February 23, 1868 in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. While growing up in a mostly European American town, W.E.B. DuBois identified himself as mulatto, but freely attended school with whites and was enthusiastically supported in his academic studies by his white teachers. In 1885, he moved to Nashville, Tennessee to attend Fisk University. It was there that he first encountered Jim Crow laws. For the first time, he began analyzing the deep troubles of American racism. In 1895, he became the first African-American to earn a PhD from Harvard University. DuBois wrote extensively and was the best-known spokesperson for African-American rights during the first half of the 20th century. He co-founded the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People in 1909. DuBois died in Ghana in 1963. Our presentation this evening is in the year 1933, and without further ado, I would like to introduce W.E.B. DuBois.
Thank you, Mrs. Brenner, and good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I have been asked to talk about the legacy of the Great War. So therefore, I'm going to tell you a story. And this story will be about how a small group of leaders working intraracially and interracially managed for a period of time to, in many ways, overcome the problem of how one turns the homeland security threat into a national security asset. This issue of problem, I was speaking with some students this afternoon at one of the colleges here in the city. I thought about my major professor, Mr. Albert Bushnell Hart. He always wanted his graduate students, especially his PhD students in Harvard, to consider the issue of problem. He always asked us, what problem do you want to spend your creative energy trying to adjust and solve. What's your problem? Well, in 1900, at the first Pan-African Congress in London, I made the statement that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. The relation of the races in Africa, America, and the islands of the sea. Certainly we know in terms of a war in the year 1860, the problem of the color line reared its head down in South Carolina and plunged our country in a great civil war. Then in 1914, in Europe, the problem of the color line reared its head again and plunged the Europeans into a continental civil war. Thus, this problem of the color line is something that has remained with us. Though, I try to be an optimist, but when I think about that war, that tragedy, it's a little difficult to be optimistic when you think about when the savage part of our being as fully modern humans erupts. But then again, when I think about our own civil war, and I think about the ending of that war and the changes, structural changes it brought about, the 13th, the 14th, and the 15th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, the 13th Amendment outlawing slavery and involuntary servitude, the 14th Amendment granting citizenship to any person who is born on American soil, and the 15th Amendment granting all men, black men included, the right to vote in this country, well, there is the fact that there can be some good that can come out of war. Thus, this leads me to my subject of leadership. Many of you have perused my first major book called The Souls of Black Folk. I wrote that book in 1903. And in chapter 4 of that book, I called it A Mr. Booker T. Washington and Others. And in that chapter, I looked at Negro leadership, focusing on the Tuskegee founder, perhaps the greatest Negro leader ever existed in this country, Booker T. Washington. Several years later, I wrote another book in 1920 called The Negro. And in that book, I looked at blacks in the military. Thus, in this presentation, I'm going to see if I can combine both of those topics to look at black leadership in the American military, focusing on the Great War. I think I'll start off in personal terms. I was born in the year 1868, Great Barrington, Western Massachusetts. I was a part of the great clan of Burghards. Fully 200 years earlier, my great-great-great-grandfather, Tom Burghardt, had come through the Western Pass with his Dutch captor, Conrad Burghardt, sullen in his slavery and achieving his freedom by signing up to fight in the American Revolution during the time of General Elon. It is said that he had a son, also named Tom, that fought with Andy Jackson in the Battle of 1812. And though I never knew my own father, we do have a picture of him in the Union uniform which he wore during the American Civil War. So this idea of black men serving in the U.S. military is something that goes back in my family to the very beginnings of my family on this side of the Atlantic and to the beginnings of this country. Thus, when my dear friend, Dr. Joel Spingard, 1917, Major Spingard, who was the executive director of the NAACP, and at this point he was in the American military, asked me if I would be interested in joining the U.S. Army and being a part of that contingent that he was a member of, that is, military intelligence. I thought about that, and I could see some possibility. You know, as a sociologist, as a social scientist, one of the reasons I went south after I finished my work in 1899 was to look at the Southland. The Southland during that period of time, as they were changing a former slave laboring class into a free laboring class, was like a big social experiment. It was giving us an idea of what happened when two great races come together, a living laboratory. Thus, when we founded the NAACP in 1909, well, that organization in some ways is like a living laboratory. Because one of the questions that we had and still have is that, is it possible for black men and women in America to serve in a leadership capacity as co-equal leaders in an organization? That's the experiment we are running. So when Joel said, join the Army, be a part of military intelligence, well, I saw the Army perhaps would be like a living laboratory. Joe and I could work and perhaps in some ways influence policy. That was the idea. Of course, it didn't take me long to realize that the Army wanted no parts of me. So I did not go in, but Dr. Spinyard stayed. Other issue we had to deal with was in terms of recruitment people, in terms of the popularity of the war. War wasn't very popular among the white population, and it certainly wasn't popular among the black population. In fact, it said that there was a certain gentleman up there in Harlem made the statement, those German people ain't never done nothing to me, and if they have, I forgive them. Well, I can understand that. And when I began to look at the war and to consider it objectively, it was pretty easy to see that, no, it was not the German people, but it was the leadership of the German Republic. And personally, I had and still have a very warm feeling toward Germany and the German people, because I spent 2 years of my graduate work in Germany. After I finished my master's under Professor Hart, I wanted to look not only at history but sociology. But I didn't want to look at the way it was taught in American schools, Yale, Harvard, that fiction that calls itself social science. I wanted to go someplace else, and looking around the world, I said, well, what's a good place to go? Well, it was clear that the French universities did not encourage any Americans, white or black, to come to study there. And the British universities looked upon a Harvard degree with about as much respect that Harvard had looked upon a Fisk degree. But never mind. The best universities for this new social science as a research-based institution were in Germany. And the best of the best, Frederick Wilhelm University, the University of Berlin, and off to Germany I went, spent 2 years there, and it was while I was in Germany that I came into my fullest, widest, most human self, so I have a warm feeling for the German people, but it was that leadership. Thus, in recognizing that, I wrote an essay which was published in our magazine, The Crisis, which is the official journal of the NAACP, which I founded, and I entitled that Closed Ranks. And in that essay, I made the case that yes, we as Negro people in this country have our issues, particularly with this idea and this ideology of white supremacy. We've been fighting it ever since we've been here. Yes, it's still a problem, but long as this war lasts, what we need to do is to close ranks with all the rest of the American people, get that war settled, and then come back and work on it. And that was what we did. Now, in the Civil War, the question was, will they fight? When President Lincoln issued this order through Secretary of War Stanton that said that black men, as a result of the Emancipation Proclamation, would be allowed into the Union Army, the state of Massachusetts was given the privilege to raise the first free black regiment. Governor Andrew raised the regiment, and they would send this free black unit down. But as they moved south, the idea was is that this army would not only be an army to save the Union, but it would eventually be an army of liberation. And slaves would join the army and more and more and more and push down, and it would expand as a black fighting force. Others said, well, that's interesting theory. But what's going to happen is that once these ex-slaves look up and see their former slave masters, the rebels coming at them, they're going to throw down their guns and they're going to run. Well, our boys at the Massachusetts 54 proved at Fort Wagner that that was not the case, that they would fight. So in the Great War, the question was, can they leave? Because you see, in the Civil War, when Governor Andrew asked Robert Gould Shaw to be the colonel to head the regiment, all the leaders, all the officers were white. You had black enlisted men and you had black sergeants, but all the commissioned officers were white. And so the question is, can we develop a professional class of Negro leaders? So in a conversation with Dr. Spinyard, he was talking to me about a conversation that he had had with his neighbor, a man by the name of General Leonard Wood. General Leonard Wood had been at one time the chief of staff of the army. And they had started this campaign even as early as 1914, 1915, called a preparedness campaign, even though, you know, Mr. Wilson ran on the promise in 1912 that he would keep us out of any wars. But it was still anticipated that perhaps we would have to enter the war, and they wanted to work to develop young white men as leaders, and they began to beef up the National Guard. Well, the question was, would they develop Negro leaders? Well, Secretary of War Newton Baker said that they would. Then the question was, well, would they be trained in a segregated training camp or in an integrated training camp? Well, he said they would be trained in a segregated training camp. Well, I had a problem with that. Dr. Spinyard said to me, now look, Burkhardt, this is not theory. We are working on a time clock, and we either got to get them trained in segregated training camps or they won't be trained at all. So you have a choice. Well, I'm a realist, but I did my first degree at Harvard and at Fisk in philosophy. So I'm also a pragmatist as well. So I understood that that was the way we wanted to go. So it would be a segregated camp. So therefore, they decided that the 17th Provisional Training Camp would be set up in Des Moines, Iowa, in Fort Des Moines. They began to put out the orders to get black men to sign up. Now, this is the place where the professional class of Negro men stepped up to the plate. At Howard University there in Washington, D.C., a young instructor by the name of Charles Hamilton Houston and others set up a group. They call it the Central Committee of Negro College. This was young college-trained professors and students and graduate students at, you know, the white schools they were going to and the black schools, because the Army said they needed 1,000 qualified men to volunteer to go to the school, and they would also take 250 senior sergeants from the 9th and 10th Cavalry and the 24th and 25th Infantry out of the regular army, the so-called Buffalo Soldiers. Well, in a short time, they had that 1,000 men. Army told them, said, well, we have a problem. The men that you have brought in are between the ages of 18 and 25, and we're going to need men between the ages of 25 and 40. Well, no problem, 3 weeks they had that. So therefore, you had 1,000 men, college-trained, professional, to volunteer, 250 men from the regular army, 1,250 men, went through the program. 4 months later, you had 639 that graduated, and this started the training of professional leaders in the United States Army. That was the first example of legacy. Now here we see sort of a difference, a similarity between, again, the Civil War and the World War. In the Civil War, it was Governor Andrew which asked Robert Gould Shaw to raise the Massachusetts 54. In the Great War, it was Governor Whitman of New York that asked a man from the state of Colorado, interesting, by the name of Charles Haywood. In fact, he was a very prominent citizen in Colorado, had been the head of the Colorado National Guard. He was living in New York at that particular time. And he was commissioned to be the colonel to head the New York 15th, which would be the Black National Guard unit in Harlem. Also had signed up, there was a man by the name of James Reese Europe. Sergeant, went through training, became a first lieutenant infantry officer, trained as a machine gunner. In fact, Jim Europe was perhaps the most famous Negro in America. He was a band leader, he was a union organizer, he was a composer, he was the man who had the vision that he wanted to move ragtime music into a classical music. And so Jim was there, and the colonel came to him and said, Lieutenant, we want you to organize a band for the regiment. And Jim said, well, colonel, he said, I didn't sign up to be a band leader. He said, I'm an infantry officer. I'm a machine gunner. That's what I want to be. And the colonel said, well, Lieutenant, I understand that. He said, but the recruitment isn't going too well. As a matter of fact, you and I and one or two others are members of a regiment of which we are the only members. But now, if you raise a band, we think this would help our recruitment effort. Now, Jim Ewell, I don't know if any of you remember this very famous ballroom couple by the name of Irene and Vernon Castle that traveled all over the country and all over Europe. Well, Jim Ewell was their orchestra leader. You know, they were the one that had all those animal dances, the fox trot, and the buzzard trot, and the chicken trot. Well, all those trots were based on Jim's wonderful arrangements. Well, anyway, he agreed to do that. Went down to Puerto Rico and recruited 20 reed players, saxophone players and clarinet players. We didn't have very many reed players in those days. In fact, Puerto Rico had the best reed players probably on this side of the continent. And sure enough, the band was formed. They had a full contingent. Now we got to do the advanced training. They decide they're going to send them down to Spartanburg, South Carolina. Well, that's where the problem started. Word got out, the mayor of Spartanburg and the city council and the chamber of commerce, you know, made it quite clear. You will not send those northern Negroes down here in South Carolina. Now, you can send southern Negroes to be trained, that's fine. They know the rules. But you send them northern Negroes down here, we're going to have problems because they're going to be expecting to be treated like white folks. And we're going to treat them like we treat our southern Negroes, so don't send them down here. And at that point, Emmett J. Scott, who had been appointed as the special assistant to Secretary of War Newton Baker, Emmett Scott, some of you may know, had been Booker T. Washington's close confidant and secretary. He went down, checked the situation out, came back and reported to the secretary. He said, Mr. Secretary, he said, you can't yield to this. He said, this is a matter of national honor. These men are wearing the uniform of the United States, and they have to be trained where they're supposed to be trained. So the secretary sent them down. Now, you know, Haywood was an interesting strategist. Went down and he called all his men together, all of his officers, his white officers and his black officers, his NCOs and all of his enlisted men. And he had them to understand that they were not just representing New York. They were representing the whole race. He said, because if we fail, they're going to disband us and your whole race of people are going to fail. This whole experiment was going to fail. So I want everyone to agree that whatever happened, you're going to take it. You're going to suck it up and you're going to take it. And they agreed to do that. But then, you know, they are always extenuating circumstances. Now, it just so happened that the white National Guard unit from New York City was also stationed in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And so some members of the white National Guard came upon some of the local white men who were accosting some of the New York 15th. And they walked up to him and they said, look, now these guys promised their colonel that they would take it. We didn't make any such promise to our colonel. You touch them again, we're going to mop the floor with you. And at that point, it began to escalate, right? And the colonel said, well, this Saturday, why don't we just have a concert and they show off the band? And then we think that would smooth things over, but it didn't happen. And so he then realized that we got to leave. We got to go now. So on December 18, 1917, the New York 15th set sail to France. Interesting thing happened there. They were eventually assigned not to remain with the American Expeditionary Force. They were assigned to serve with the French, and they became the 369th Infantry, even though President Wilson had promised the American people that no Americans would serve under a British or French general, but they assigned it. And that wasn't really a bad thing. Why? Because they left Spartanburg and they didn't really have the training. In fact, no unit, black unit or white unit, really had the proper training because we were under such time pressure. But once they got there and they were serving with the French, they were serving with soldiers who had been in trench warfare for 3 years. They understood how to fight. So ultimately, that worked in their favor. And so just as they were about to step off the boat, well, Colonel said to Jim, crank up the band. And so they got out. Now, okay. They're serving with the French, got to tell you this. Colonel Haywood was not just a good strategist, he was also well placed. See, I told you he grew up in Nebraska. In fact, he went to school at the university there, at Lincoln. In fact, he got his law degree also there in Lincoln. And while he was an undergraduate, he took officer training, reserve training. And his training officer just happened to be a young captain by the name of John J. Pershing. So he was well connected. And so when they step off the band, they stepped off playing this music, and the French, you know, heard them. And then all of a sudden, they jumped to attention. See, the French all of a sudden realized that the tune that they were playing was the Marseillaise, the French national anthem. They didn't know the tune because, see, the band played it with a beat. And so after it was over, the head of the French army sent word that he wanted Jim Europe to send copies of their composition. And then they came back several days later, and he said, no, he said, I want the composition that you played.
He said, well, this is what we play. And he said, also, I brought two of my band members. They want to take a look at those special made instruments that you all have. He said, special made instruments? He said, well, a sousaphone was a sousaphone. A trumpet is a trumpet, a trombone is a trombone. That's nothing special about what we have. See, they couldn't understand how these brothers could get that sound out of those instruments. Thus, they became so popular that General Pershing authorized them to go on a 10,000-mile trip all over France. So the first introduction that the French public had to the American Expeditionary Force came when they met the New York 15th, the 369th Infantry Band, under the leadership of James Reese Ewell. Colonel Haywood also has an explanation as to how the French received these black troops. The French called them les enfants perdus, that is, the abandoned children, the abandoned babies. And Colonel Haywood tells the story this way. He said, well, it's as though the American high command put us in a little basket and he walked up to the door of the French high command, set the basket down, rang the bell, and then walked away. And the French officers came out and said, welcome to the black babies. And there we were. There was also another person in the band. And this has to do with not only the culture, but breaking stereotypes. Remember I told you there was a young man at Howard University named Charles Hamilton Houston? Well, Houston went through the provisional training, and he came out as a first lieutenant in infantry. And he served with the 92nd Division. 369 was the 93rd Division. And then he decided he wanted to go to artillery school. So he went to artillery school and came out a second lieutenant and considered that an advancement. Now, you wonder, well, wait a minute now. How is it that he graduated as a first lieutenant in infantry and then graduated as a second lieutenant in artillery and couldn't consider that an advancement? Well, this has to do with how the war was fought. See, we didn't have any mass groups of troops and tanks or thousands of men. Trench warfare, they would be separated sometimes maybe a couple of a score distance between the Germans over here and the French over here, and they were in these long trenches. And what the artillery officers would have to do when our boys went over the top, they would have to make the calculation and fire the artillery and the rounds would go up and boom, hit on that first line of troops that we would go in, and then we would keep pushing further, then they'd have to calculate and follow the next, boom, and boom, boom. Well, as infantry, well, that's brute force. Well, black people have proved they could do that in World War I, earlier, later, and they proved it in the Civil War. But artillery required a mathematical calculation to be able to make the arc and come down at just the right place. And the army just did not have confidence that black men had a sufficient mental power to do that type of particular calculation. And that's why Lieutenant Houston and other black officers wanted to go into artillery to prove objectively that they could do the type of calculations to do that. Well, to make a long story short, the 369th spent 191 days in the trenches, longer than any other unit in the American Expeditionary Forces, though they weren't under the American Guard. They never lost a foot of ground. They were the most decorated unit in the entire war. There was a time when the only thing that stood between the German army and Paris was this group of black soldiers and their white officers. And there was a period of time where they were moving forward and the French general told the colonel, retreat, retreat. And Colonel Haywood said, retreat?
He said, "My boys never retreat." He said, "They either move forward or they die." And they took off, he took off his crown and insignia, threw it down and moved forward. He was injured. And then another time they were advancing so rapidly that the French general said, "Stop them, stop them, stop them." Colonel Haywood said, "Stop them, stop them. Man, if the entire German army can't stop them, how the hell you think I'm going to stop them?" And then that became the legacy of this man that the Germans call hell fighters from Harlem. And they were quite concerned about that. And the reason we know that is two of the first white Americans who were captured, and they were in different parts of the country. And one of the first things that German intelligence wanted to find out is, how many Negro troops did you bring? And this one American lieutenant said, "Well, we brought 12 million. And the other man said, he wasn't as precise, he said, "We have several million." So that was a deal. And so they were successful enough that the French gave them the honor that when they moved as an invading force into France to cross the Rhine, the 369th led the charge. Even though this beautiful mural was painted by French artists giving scenes from the war, they had these brothers painted in there magnificently. The American High Command insisted wipe that out and only had white Americans. During the victory parade of the Champs-Élysées, there were units of Americans, but there was no black American seen in parade. Colonel Haywood said that, "My boys did not get a parade when they left New York. They will get a parade when we come back." And they had this incredible parade up Fifth Avenue in New York. Nevertheless, then we look at terms of legacy with the idea that what happens over there doesn't just stay over there. Sometimes the legacy of war comes with us. Remember I said Jim Europe had the idea that if he could develop this world-class band, he could form a national tour, and he could raise up the idea of a national Negro orchestra. When he came back as the most famous band in the Expeditionary Force, they had a national tour. They had just played the first performance in Boston at the Boston Commons. And they got in an argument with one of the members of the band, a young man named Herbert Wright. And Jim looked upon this young man sort of as a father figure, but something happened, and the young man took out a knife and sort of stabbed him in the neck. Blood sort of dripped. It wasn't that serious. He told the guys, he said, go on. He said, "I'll see you in New York tomorrow, and we will begin to practice for the tour." Thus, the whole world was shocked when the headline said, "Jim Europe dead, killed by one of his own band members and members." Thus, what happens in war to men in terms of tragedy just doesn't stay over there. It follows them wherever they go. Jim also had a drum major, Sergeant, later Lieutenant Noble Sissel. Remember I talked about Jim had this union of professional musicians that played throughout upstate New York and New England. There were actually three people in that union. It was Jim Europe, it was Noble Sissel, and there was another musician named U.B. Blake. U.B. didn't go because U.B. was a little bit too old, and so he didn't go. But Jim had this also, he had been a part of Black Broadway. And Sissel and Blake wrote a musical called Shuffle Along. And it opened on Broadway to a magnificent run, and that became the first installment of American theater to American musical comedy. Also, this young man, Charles Hamilton Houston, when he left the Provisional Training Unit, his first assignment was to the JAG Corps. He wasn't a lawyer, but he became an advocate for two black sergeants who were brought up on charges. He saw how unfairly they were treated. He said to himself, "If I'm lucky enough to survive this war, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to be an advocate for my people." So when he finished college, he finished Amherst College there in Massachusetts, and he said he didn't know what he wanted to do with himself. His father, who was a lawyer, who wanted him to become a lawyer, he didn't want to go into the family business, but he got him a lawyer teaching literature at Howard University.
Well, Hamilton graduated from college, Phi Beta Kappa, 19 years old. No wonder he didn't know what he wanted to do with himself. But he then decided, I am going to be a lawyer. So he went to Harvard University, he got his degree there, became the first black to be an editor of the Harvard Law Review. And he went to Howard to become a dean of the law school. And Howard, at this point, had his first black president, a man named Mordecai Johnson. And President Johnson said he wanted his chief administrative officers and academic officers to not just have one doctorate, but two. And so he then went to the University of Madrid in Spain and came back to Howard and set up and began and invented the field of civil rights law. And he began to train the next generation of black lawyers. People like Constance Baker Motley, who was the first black woman to be a federal judge. People like William Hasty, his cousin, to be the first black man to become a federal judge. And after a while, he also always kept his favorite student right next to him when he was working, a man by the name of Thurgood Marshall. Mm-hmm. Now, Houston was a brilliant strategist. He decided that he was going to challenge the Jim Crow system. You know, 96, Plessy versus Ferguson, separate but equal. And so he and Thurgood got the idea that, you know, if we can go down south and we can get a Negro down there to bring a case, we could argue this case perhaps all the way to the Supreme Court and see if it dealt with what the Constitutional said. So therefore, you go down, let's say, if you were down there, which they did, say a school system. We said, well, we got two school systems. We got the Negro school system, we got the white school system. Well, let's look at appropriations per student. Appropriation for the white student, appropriation for the black students. Is they are separate, but is it equal? Well, we said, well, let's look at the physical plant. We got the white school, we got the black school. They are separate, but when you look at the two facilities, are they equal? Or let's take teacher salary. You got the salaries that the black teacher paid and the salaries that the white teachers are paid. They're certainly separate, but are they equal? Well, if they aren't equal, ha, we got a case. And he realized there was no town anywhere who could afford to have two identical, separate, and equal school systems. It would break the system. That was what he did. They also now working to challenge the white primary in Texas. See, in Texas, as in much of the South, the Democratic Party is a private club. Now, certainly the 15th Amendment gave black men the right to vote, the 19th Amendment gave all women the right to vote. But that was in the general election. But the Democratic Party in Texas, being a private club, where they can establish the criteria who would be a member of their club. And so therefore, they could decide who's going to vote in the Democratic primary. Now, the problem with that is that the South, and certainly Texas, is a Democratic state. And if you don't vote in the Democratic primary, it doesn't matter because there's not enough Republicans. So you are disenfranchised. So he's working on that case. Also, when we look at, when I went to Paris in 1919 as a representative of the press corps with President Wilson, I had three objectives. One is that as a member of the NAACP, we were going to convene the second Pan-African. We were going to force the issue of what President Wilson called a special development. And that's the ability of each country to determine if they're going to develop themselves in the way they want it to do, democratically. So the question we have, what's going to happen to those ex-colonies of Germany, particularly Southwest Africa? Are they going to have the right to develop themselves the way they want it? We know they gave it to Jan Smuts and Union of South Africa, but that didn't happen. I also wanted to interview black troops to see how this experiment in interracial leadership worked, because I wanted to write a book about that. And then finally, I wanted to just to get a feel for the city, for the country. And what I began to understand was this lasting legacy that we now see as the, oh, I guess
guess I could call it a love affair between the French people and American Negroes. And those of us who were fortunate enough to be among the elite classes, we've been traveling back and forth to France for 200 years. And so I'd been there a couple of times myself. So we knew that the French had a different view of what democracy was about, fraternity, liberty, and equality. But when we had thousands of ordinary, everyday Negroes who went over there and found that this was a place of white people who could treat them as human beings, and they came back and tell that story, then that would be a hope that possibly America could develop to them. So, as of this year, 1933, because I've been forced out of my own organization, NAACP, but that's another story. But we moved back to Atlanta, and we've set up the Department of Sociology at Atlanta University. And I've established another magazine. I just like establishing magazines. This one is called Phylon, and it will be a peer-reviewed journal that black graduate students and others and professionals can have a place to publish our own research. Thus, I think of it in many ways in the same way that the great Frederick Douglass said about black leaders. We have to always be in a position to agitate. Thank you. A monologue, and then comments or critiques. That's what democracy is all about. You have a right to agree, disagree, to express. I saw a hand over here. Yes, sir.
You trace the black situation in the Civil War and World War One. And how do you assess the black situation in our military today?
Well, we still have this legacy of leadership that was established in a provisional training regiment in 1917. We now have a group of black officers that came out of that experiment. When I was over in France, I was in a country where there were two black generals, there were four black four-bird colonels, and there were hundreds of black majors and lieutenant colonels. We only had really one black field great officer when the war started, and that was Colonel Charles Young. He had distinguished himself in Africa, had distinguished himself with General Pershing down in Mexico. In fact, it was Pershing who actually promoted him to lieutenant colonel. And when the war started, we figured that he would lead a regiment. However, he had to take an exam, and though he was given high praise by his peers, other officers, in this case, of course, all white, but that was what the officers were. The army decided that he wasn't fit, and he did have high blood pressure, but they knew that if he stayed in as a third colonel, he would become a general. And the idea was that no white soldier would be under the command of a black officer. Colonel Young said that I'm fit, and to make his case, he's from Wilberforce, Ohio. He rode horseback from Wilberforce to Washington, D.C., but it didn't happen. Then after the war was over, the army certainly realized they had this great general, this great officer. They reinstated him back in the army again as a field colonel. So we still have our issues, but the major legacy was that we started this a tradition of black officers in the training corps, and it continues to go. The Army, of course, is still segregated. And there's a labor leader, and also a journalist by the name of E. Phil Randolph, and he's talking to the president about having some type of boycott or a parade to protest a segregated armed forces. So it's still segregated, but you do have the full contingent of black field grade officers down to junior officers. So it's getting better in that sense.
Yes, sir.
Was there any black regiment that fought with the AEF? You said 369 was actually fought with the French.
Yes.
I thought they went
No, the Harlem Regiment fought with the French, and they commissioned the 369th. Then the 370th fought with the French, but the other two regiments fought with the American Expeditionary Force. And of course, you know, most soldiers were not fighters, white or black.
Right.
Most of the black troops were a part of what was called the Pioneer Infantry, and also a part of the supply, the SOS, Service of Supplies. And so, but in terms of fighters, it was the 369th that fought with the French, and the 370th. Yes, sir.
Dr. DuBois, can you tell us about your family?
About my family, yes. as I said, I come from a long line of Burkhardts. I never knew my father. There were rumors about it. You know, they were a very close-knit family, the Burkhardts, dark-skinned folk. And that was this, what was called this high yellow pretty Negro. Came through, and my mother was living in a different city. They wanted her to stay there, and he seemed to have just sort of swept her off of her feet. And the rumors was that some of her brothers and cousins went out and made friendly gestures toward this pretty Negro, and he was never seen again. And then they had her back where they wanted her in. But she was a great inspiration for me. Then, when I left there, I only saw his father once in New Bedford, Massachusetts. This is after I graduated from high school. And I went there, and grandfather was talking to another gentleman. And I was just looking through the door, and it was just something about how they carried themselves. I've just never seen that with Negroes before. How they toasted each other with wine, and how they carried themselves. So that was that line of my father was through my father. In terms of my own family, my wife and I have one daughter that still lives, Yolanda. We had one young son, Burkhardt, who died as an infant. He contracted some disease there, and we couldn't get him to the hospital. Of course, the best doctors in Atlanta at that time were the white doctors and the white hospitals, but they wouldn't accept even a black child there. And so by the time they figured out what happened, you know, he had passed on. And so my wife, Yolanda, and I, so that's my family. Immediate family. Yes, sir.
Tell me about your conflict with the NAACP.
Oh, my conflict with the NAACP. Well, remember I said I was a pragmatist, even though I've Mr. William James is my philosophy professor. And this had to do with, I guess, looking at the situation realistically. And one of the arguments that I was making in terms of a new philosophy, and that was to develop our own institutions, our own educational institutes, higher education, our own businesses to the best degree that they can. That we live in a segregated society. We were segregated yesterday, we segregated tomorrow, and so forth. I can see we're gonna be segregated day after tomorrow. Now, that's not the end, but the question I'm raising is what do we do in the meantime? And my argument is that you develop Negro organizations so that they become second to none in the world. NAACP took issue with that because they said, well, that sounds as though you're compromising with segregation. And I'm saying to them, the NAACP never took an official position on segregation. So I'm not arguing against what the NAACP is saying. I'm just being realistic. And that's the argument that I'm making wherever I go. And that's not the political position with those in power, particularly when my friend, Mr. James Weldon Johnson, who came aboard as the first black executive director in 1920 until 1930, and Mr. Walter White has now taken over. That's not his position. And so we got internal power structure. And the idea is that, well, Dr. DuBois, you served your time, and we appreciate the effort that you've done. But it's now time for new leadership, which I understand. As myself one who believes in leaders. But I still have my position, I still make that position, it's my position, and I think I can make that position independently of the NAACP, but the powers that be had other ideas. So that's sort of about it. Yes?
Your family is a black family in Western Massachusetts, what?
Well, in New York City now, but,
No, but
Oh, the Burkhardts, yes, yeah. Yes.
What was it like for them? Were they accepted? Were they kind of?
Yes, the question was, how were the Burkhardts and the few Negro families there accepted? Quite well. You know, Great Barrington is a small place, and, well, sort of being black New Englanders, being New England, there's just a certain way of carrying yourself. And there wasn't the same obvious class divides, even among the white population, people who had lots of money. You look at them and you never know what they had. You just didn't advertise that self. So we were poor, but you didn't really think of yourself as poor. That's just how you were. And so, yes, they were quite accepted, as were most black folk in the Great Barrington. Things began to change a little bit when the migration of Southern blacks started to move up from the South and also from the West Indies. And we saw that in immigrants coming from Eastern Europe as well, sort of a divide. But it wasn't so much a racial issue, it was just an issue of people coming from another culture. But no, as a matter of fact, my principal, Frank Hosmer, if he had been the type of white man to think that the only thing that a black boy could be would be a carpenter, he would have steered me toward the shop classes, Mr. Booker T. Washington's idea of industrial education. But he saw my potential, and therefore he moved me toward the advanced classes. I wanted to go to Harvard immediately, didn't have the money, so he got together with four churches in the community and raised the money to send me to Fisk University to pay my expenses there. Once I graduated with my first undergraduate from Fisk, I then went to Harvard on a scholarship and did another undergrad in philosophy, then a master's in history. And Mr. James told me, well, you know, Willie, the world isn't used to having a Negro with a philosophy degree to make a living. So I think you need something more practical. And that's why I went into social science. Oh, I have been told that I have another appointment, but I'm told in these type of programs that another person come out and answer a question as far as page that DuBois could not or maybe would not answer in his character. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to know if Dr. DuBois had influence on Margaret Sanger or vice versa.
I don't know if he had influence on her, but she certainly had an influence on him. He was very much a woman's rights man. He believed in the rights of women to choose the type of life they wanted to live, and he's on record about that. So he knew of her work. I don't know how much she influenced him, but I would say that he did influence her. Now, an interesting question to raise that question in terms of said legacy. Let me just sort of bring it up to modern times. Remember, I talked about Noble Sissel and Hubert Blake writing a musical called Shuffle Along. Well, that music was revived 2 years ago for the first time on Broadway. It was so well respected and it carried even into modern time, it was nominated for 10 Tony Awards. Unfortunately, it was up against another musical called Hamilton. So it didn't win, okay? Charles Hamilton Houston was the first black student at Harvard to be a member of the Harvard Law Review. We know that Barack Obama was the first black Harvard Law student to be the editor of the Harvard Law Review, okay? We also see the influence of Charles Hamilton Houston in the sense that President Obama, one of his two appointments was Elena Kagan. Elena Kagan, at the time he appointed her, was the dean of the Harvard Law School, but of course, as dean, she was also a faculty member. And her faculty position was, she was the Charles Hamilton Houston Distinguished Professor of Law at Harvard University. And so it still comes in. So we're still looking to see this legacy moving into the 21st century to this very day in terms of these things. But questions, other questions to me? Yes, sir.
This short biography on the handout says that you conducted performance-based public diplomacy. Now, what is that? I've never heard of that.
Yes, my major professor had never heard of public diplomacy either. Well, public diplomacy, that's a term that we sometimes use the term winning hearts and minds. It became very popular during the Vietnam War.
Yeah, performance-based
is
what?
I'm a performer, meaning that what I did was that I did performances of American characters overseas in Africa and to talk about, the idea is that you take American culture abroad. And as Edward R. Murrow said, it's good to send signals 30,000 miles on Voice of America. He said, but if you really want to communicate with people so that they understand who you are and what your culture is, it doesn't happen over 20,000 miles. It happened over what Murrow called the final 3 feet.
Yeah.
And that's between one human heart and another human heart. Then you know the people. We know our cultural exchange program, a student exchange program, is an example of public diplomacy. And so when we send, when President Nixon opened up the relationship with China, they sent what table tennis players, ping pong diplomacy. In 1955, during the Eisenhower administration, the first Americans to travel throughout the Soviet Union was a tour of Porgy and Bess. Maya Angelou was a part of that tour. They are there. We now had an official form of diplomacy called sports diplomacy when we sent people, Dennis Rodman over in North Korea. Now that was Dennis doing this on his own, but the idea was relating in terms of sports. We also have medical diplomacy. We send medical doctors, the Ebola crisis, the World Health Organization. So the idea is that professionals will leave one country, go to another country and interact with your peers. And so that lets people know there is a difference between American policy and the American people. There's a difference between whatever any individual administration has as his or her policy and American culture. And so they separate those two, and that's called public diplomacy or cultural diplomacy.
But as far as performance,
Oh, okay.
Is that, what characters do you portray? You give me characters that typify parts of the American spirit or something like that?
Yes, yes. Now, when we talk about sports, medicine, everybody is a performer. Some people are lecturers, okay?
Yeah.
So the characters that I did was Malcolm X, which I toured Colorado, Frederick Douglass, and also I did another show called Theory in Black, which was a whole series of characters. I also did a series of seminars and workshops where my theme was leadership, entrepreneurship, and citizenship with my peers who were also in theater. And I also did sessions on creativity and the creative process. One of the things, years later, my graduate training is in anthropology. And one of the reasons I wanted to be in American studies anthropology to see if I could get a theory to explain what it is I've been doing all these years that's not aesthetic basis. And one of the things that we know about our species, Homo sapiens sapiens, we perform. And one of the ways we bridge the gap between self and other is through ritual experience, through performance experience, whether it's secular or whether it's sacred. And in many ways, it's all sacred. Sacred in the sense of not religion, but something that's set aside. When you sit down and you share a meal with another person, that's a form of ritual expression that all humans do. But it's amoral. It brings people together, sometime around bad ideas. Du Bois was ending the show.
show in 1933. In 1933, 1934, he was seeing what Hitler and Joseph Goebbels was doing in these mass crusades. There's a case of a British man talking about he was in Germany, and he was and he happened to be there when one of those mass crusades was going, and he said that as abhorrent as the whole idea was him, when he was among 20 or 30,000 Germans jumping up going Sieg Heil, it was all he could do to keep himself in the seat and not jump up to become a part of it. That's the power of performance. That's the power of the group mind. So the question is, how do you engineer that process? So in terms of applied anthropology, we engineer it in terms of bringing people together socially, and then we can talk about it in terms of ideas. So one of the places that tested that for me in terms of this idea and ideology of white supremacy was in the closing days of the Carter administration, and I was back in the opening days of the Reagan administration, and I was in the most divided country on earth in terms of divide, was apartheid South Africa. But when we get South Africans, black, whites, Indians, within the American culture center, that's American diplomatic space. So American rules will apply. And so for me, we were experimenting with what their society could look like in a post-apartheid society. And so I'm working with local people who are leading the, who at that time were leading the change from apartheid society to a post-apartheid society. Then when I went into their theaters and their cultural centers, it was the same thing. It was their experiment among each other to say that we can relate to each other, all as South Africans, but see each other in the way that the man in prison by the name of Nelson Mandela sees people. They could experiment with that long before it came a reality. Langston Hughes talked about dreams. He said, always dream, hold fast to your dreams. This favorite Beatle of mine talked about imagine and imagination. So you'll start here and then you move it out in the society and you play out these rituals and then you can make those rituals come through. And performance is how our species, Homo sapiens sapiens, and even higher primates use it in terms of ritual experience to communicate that aesthetically, to communicate it volitionally in terms of your action and also emotionally. So that's what I was doing with there. Other questions?
So Mr. Europe, what's his
James Reese Europe, yes, sir.
I've heard about that band, but he died when he...
That's right, that's right. And the problem was, he was bleeding and they could never get it to stop. So he literally bled to death. Mm-hmm. You can go online and there are videos of a film of him and with the band, and you can see the parade marching up Fifth Avenue, and you can see him conducting the band, you can see him playing the music that he played with the Castles. So we can all, it's all on YouTube now. Everything's on YouTube.
Yeah. there's another character that I know is Willie the Lion Smith.
Oh, Willie the Lion Smith.
He was part of that artillery.
Yes, he was. Now, he wasn't, to my knowledge, he wasn't a soldier, but Willie the Lion Smith was one of those New York piano players. Scott Joplin had come from Texarkana to Missouri to New York. Then you had the guys coming from New Orleans to Chicago into New York. And New York was bringing everybody together. So it was during that time where the culture center of the Western world was moving from London, Paris, Berlin to New York City.
But
so Willie the Lion Smith was a part of that.
My understanding, though, is that he got his name, the Lion, from being he was in that artillery.
Oh, that could have been. I just don't know his personal story, so I don't know if he was or not. But
he was very proud.
Okay. Then that's good for me to know. I'll put him into that category. I've not read his story, but okay. Yes. Paul, I just found out reading something recently that Paul Robeson Brothers' brother was also a part of this contention. Now, of course, we always have to deal with books, and this is just real quick. This is the best book I found to look at blacks in the military, to go along with your question about how have things changed. This is by a lady named Gail Buckley. And the name Gail Buckley may not mean anything to you, but for many of you in here, her mother's name would. She's the daughter of Lena Horne. This is Rick Top on the she had a club at the Longmont district. It's called Paris Noir. This tells the story of those blacks who stayed in France and others who went there as black expatriates to develop an artistic and intellectual community in Paris from 1918 up until I think this was in 2006. This was called African Americans in the City of Light. African Americans in the City of Light. This is the best biography of W.E.B. DuBois. This is a composite of a two-volume biography that David Levering Lewis published on DuBois. The first volume was from 1868 to 1918. The second volume was from 1918 to 1963. He's combined. Interesting enough, it's a great read. Both of these volumes won Pulitzer Prizes in history. This is the best book I found on blacks in World War I by Professor Chad Williams called Torchbearers of Democracy. And this is the book by the other scholar in this series who will be making an appearance not tomorrow night, night after tomorrow night, whatever day that is, at Regis University, Professor Trout, and there will be a panel discussion with other World War I scholars there, and it's called The Battlefield of Memory. He is a literature professor. He's at the University of North Alabama. This is a book which tells the story of these black officers and their training, and he brings them all the way up in terms of this tradition to the year 2010, black officers in the military. And there were three black women who were in France, and this one tells two of their stories. It's called Two Colored Women in World War I France. And they wrote it's a wonderful series of scenes, and they were part of the contingent of YMCA secretaries who were there to give aid and comfort, recreation and education to troops. And finally, this is called Seeing Red. This tells the story of the military intelligence and also the Bureau of Intelligence, the FBI, and their tracking of militants and people who threaten, in their mind, the national security threat. Whether you're talking about people in labor unions or you're talking about the NAACP and others. And when I talked about turning the threat into an asset, the threat that they were dealing with was that they said when these black men come back from World War I, they were treated fairly in Europe, and they're going to come back with the expectation of equality, and they're going to come back with the expectation of social equality, and that was considered a threat to U.S. national security. And so, it's an incredible story. It's an interesting story. We are still dealing with this issue and what Du Bois called the color line and what social scientists call the idea and the ideology of white supremacy and the effects that that has had on the world for the last 500 years, as contrasted with the idea of human equality. As we see from the news today, we're still dealing with that idea. It's still active in the world. I just saw a quote from the man who just left the office of Attorney General. They were talking about when the governor of Alabama said that three great threats, this was in the 1960s, was Negroism, Judaism, and Catholicism in terms of American culture. So that's what it's grounded in. And if you don't know the history of it, then it's difficult to combat it. But it's an idea, and it's
nothing but an idea. We can change ideas, and places like a library, books, other places that we do to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.